There is a story that the creators of C# had taken the specifications of C, C++ and Java and crossed out everything that wasn't good. What remained became C# 1.0. The concept of value types is one that remained. The class is a reference type and the corresponding struct is a value type. I guess that every programmer can see the profound effect of separating reference types and value types in the language. In this video, I plan to clarify when you should choose one or the other. There are three sets of questions to answer about syntax, behavior, and performance. Let's clarify the syntactic aspects of reference and value types. In C#, arguments are passed to methods and functions by value. This applies both to reference and value types. However, in the first case, the reference is the value that is copied to the argument. In the second case, the entire object is copied. This copying process makes a struct immutable even in a case when you declare its properties as mutable. The principal syntactical distinction between reference types and value types is that mutators, such as property setters, do not belong in value types. They would invariably open up the room for bugs. That leads to a different set of practices when designing methods that receive value types versus those that receive reference types. You would apply the so-called copy-on-write technique, which produces a new modified value to return. Your entire code base will look different when working with value types. Unfortunately, the C# compiler will not warn us that we haven't assigned the value returned from the call. The change is lost again, but this time due to the caller's fault. This is a typically immutable coding pattern, where we gradually build the final variable in a series of immutable transforms. While you can choose whether to treat your reference types as mutable or immutable, immutability is the only reasonable option you have with value types. The third aspect, which we often keep at the back of our minds, is speed. Small structs are blazingly fast as they avoid heap allocation. However, things will change if I declared a struct with half a dozen integers in it. What about a struct with twice that many ints in it? The problem should become obvious when we compare three invocations, each receiving a different struct argument. Larger structs incur additional cost due to copying the content over and over. Contrast that to passing an int and passing any reference type. These two calls will have the lowest cost, and that cost will always be the same irrespective of the argument type. Therefore, beware of declaring a struct solely on the grounds of performance. You will probably be fine with one or two fields in a struct. Three or more fields is the point where the result breaks even, with classes eventually turning out faster. There is no universal answer. The overall performance depends on the number of copies you will make. Let me show you one more interesting detail that directly depends on the size of a struct. I'm instantiating the whole bunch of generic lists, but they are not the same. The operation of a generic type is determined by the object layout, and the object layout depends on its size. Now, all reference types incur the same size, which is the size of the reference, but each of the structs has its own unique size in my code. The result is that the JIT compiler will emit one list implementation for all reference types and then three additional implementations for each of my structs. It would reuse an implementation if some struct had the same size as another, though. This should not worry you. I only told you this because I like the way .NET addressed the problem of compiling generic types. Java failed on this question spectacularly. All this brings us to the inevitable question of records. What would change if I declared the class as a record with the same two properties? This is still a reference type, but with some additions generated by the compiler. It will expose public immutable properties and support non-destructive mutation, which I have called copy-on-write in the case of a struct. It will also have tailor-made generated equals and gethash code implementations along with the equality operators. All this means that the instance will behave like a value while it is implemented as a reference type. We would say it has a value-typed semantics that completely changes the way we can use objects. While we can use either of the reference types when constructing a hash set, it only makes sense to do that with types that implement value-typed semantics. Using just any reference type makes a little sense because items would be compared by reference. Record classes, on the other hand, support this out of the box. The story goes the same if you attempt to use a reference type as a dictionary key. Records will shine in this role as well. The change would affect some everyday operations, like those on collections. Adding an object and then searching for it would fail on a list when a common class is used, but the same operation would succeed on a list of records. Calling distinct on a sequence of objects that do not implement value-type semantics makes a little sense. This call would isolate distinct references rather than objects with distinct content. The same call, however, would work like a charm on a sequence of records. The last interesting difference happens when we try to modify an object without destroying its existing content. This is a typical mutable operation on a class. If we wanted to treat that class as immutable, we would need to create a modified instance, like I did below, in the function that deals with a structure. Record types support with expressions, which let us specify only the properties to change, and the expression will copy the rest of the object into a new instance. A detail that may pass unnoticed here is that you will not mention the properties you don't plan to modify. In the method above, I had to list the entire state of the object only to modify one property. The with expression allows you to modify one or more properties without naming any other properties that exist. The hidden gem is that you can add a property to the record later, and all with expressions will continue to work correctly. You don't get that with custom classes and structs. The last question with which we will conclude this analysis concerns record structs. Before I explain the difference between a struct and a record struct, let me mention my Patreon page. There are more than 100 videos on this channel, all of which are free thanks to the patrons. If you are enjoying learning from videos on this channel, then please consider joining the growing community of supporters on Patreon. That will give you access to the source code of all the videos on this channel, the new course I'm working on, which is still not published, and some other goodies that are not available on YouTube. You will find the link in the description. Now, the final question awaits us, the question of record structs. When record types first appeared, they could only be reference types. The next edition of C# brought an improvement by specifying explicitly that this is a record class. You can omit the class keyword because it is assumed. However, there also came the value type variant, known as a record struct. You would define it the same as a record class by specifying the properties using the primary constructor. Defining the type this way makes it behave in all respects the same as a common struct, with a caveat. Equality members in a record struct are generated and therefore much faster than the reflection-based implementation in the traditional struct. There is also one nuance compared to record classes. While a record class is generated as immutable by default, a record struct is somewhat surprisingly generated as mutable by default. You should use the read-only keyword to enforce immutability on a record struct, so it becomes a read-only record struct in the end. This is how I use C# types nowadays. Record classes are my first choice in any immutable design. That also includes the use in serialization and when I need a DTO. Traditional mutable classes are usually reserved for entities in my designs, especially when combined with EF Core. EF Core assumes mutability. And for the lightweight types, typically with no more than two value type components, I regularly use read-only record structs.